5 seconds remaining. Team secrets turn to ban. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Dire team ban.
Like that? Hello, people. That was good cheese.
5 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Pause.
Reserve time.
Title? No. Have.
What?
Oh, you, I was just taking the same
Team
title.
Secrets turn to pick.
Yeah, I did.
Awesome. Good.
Hello, and welcome back to the Boston Major European Qualifiers. And it is Imperial and Team Secret that we are watching right now. Team Secret, I believe this is their second game so far. And they have won their first one against Na'Vi. Now, Imperial's not that lucky. Imperial lost two before. One against Virtus.pro, one against Ad Finem. And, well, they kind of... Do you know those two teams are sitting here with gods, by the way? I'm not just having them on log. Those two teams, both Virtus.pro and Ad Finem, are two teams that are looking really good right now. And if you want to be in the top four, you got to beat at least two of the other top four people that you otherwise would have in it. And Team Secret, I think, is one of those.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Talk to me about who would be top four, and I think Secret, VP, Ad Finem, all names that popped up a bit. So, the Alliance is going to be a tough team. I think Escape, of course. How can we not talk about Escape when they've been crushing it in Dream League? So, we'll see how this game unravels. Secret, I mean, they've been the talk of the town for a few months now. Obviously, scandals and stuff aside, it's the team and the name that's always meant to deliver big performances.
Yeah.
They were very close to getting an invite, I imagine, having one faced it. Just maybe one more placement in like an event like MDL. If they finished third instead of fourth, because they finished right below OG, maybe that would have been enough to get them a direct invite. But either way, I think they come into this qualifier as at least the team that's expected to go. If they don't, it's a disappointment, and like the team roster change. Yeah, that's the secret.
Yeah. Overall, I mean... Imperial is a team that people were expecting to make it through the opens. It's a team that people see as the underdog, but I think if on paper our expectations are correct, this should be a fairly one-sided game.
Yeah, right? It's hard to know with Imperial because they flirt and with Stratton will sometimes throw you off, but Secret could be like 70-30 favorites, maybe 75-25 even.
Yeah. I'd say so.
Imperial's, it's kind of misleading to just call them an open qualifier team because they were there because of some roster blocking.
Yeah.
They kind of messed up there with Baby Knight.
They would have gotten invited if they had that, though.
Yeah.
If they would have had that sorted, so.
It's weird to think, they would have been invited over, like, who knows who. One of the... Someone would have, like, Vegas. All the teams who were directly invited.
That's actually a really good point. Who would you
Because Empire was the one who got screwed over for Team Secret.
Yes.
Which was like, as far as the 8 invites, it was like, well, Empire's probably the least deserving, but the next least deserving? I don't know who that would be. It might I'd see Vega.
I'm not sure. Vega's been doing pretty okay for them.
Yeah, that's the thing. I feel like that's insulting to Vega because they've been doing really well.
Everybody's been
Alliance is doing really well. Na'Vi hasn't been playing, but again, you can't not invite Na'Vi. They kept their roster stable. They were at TI and haven't changed their roster.
And that is such a big factor. Like, Valve doesn't make it a secret that is something that they value highly. Stability.
Maybe Imperial wouldn't have been invited anyways. I don't know. They won WSD, though. If you win a land, you have to get at least invited to regional.
At Finnum.
Yeah, okay, sure. At Finnum. That's tough for at Finnum. Especially because they... Remaining. So at Finnum, two Valve events in a row have finished one slot away from qualifying for land. At Manila, they lost the best of five finals to Empire, 3-2. And then at TI, they lost in the Reserve match time. Before... They lost to Escape.
They've been so close.
To the Wild Card. I feel bad for those guys. They're always just one game away. Same with the Summit. They've lost twice in the finals of Europe, although one time they luckily got to go because VP pulled out. But
so close.
If they didn't
so
get in regionals because it's like, oh, sorry. We're going to put Imperial in. Like, they'd just be like, what? How is that possible?
Yeah, they would have been pretty upset. Now, this way, I mean, it's a little bit of a luck scenario than for all the other teams. There's no doubt about it who's going to get an invite over Imperial if Imperial can't make it to the regionals. But... this specific game, Imperial opened up with a Darkseer Oracle and Ogre Magi for Juggernaut and Juggernaut for Team Secret. What do you reckon?
I mean, fairly standard. I mean, since they much as the pick came out, it's kind of always curious to see more of the direction they go. Imperial picking up Darkseer with Oracle, since Oracle's kind of a counter to the Darkseer, they make sure they pick the two together and also get some a hero for Ryze. Very good on his Rubick and Oracle, probably his two best heroes. Noteworthy things for me is that Secret obviously doing their research, banning out the Batrider that's been Hestajo's best hero and probably Imperial's most high impact hero.
Yeah.
At WSD when Imperial were winning, teams were like, oh, do we ban the Centaur? Do we ban these cheesy picks they do? I think banning the Batrider was actually the biggest problem here.
Yeah. What do you think? Yeah, and they actually played Centaur earlier today against Virtus Pro. Ace was playing Centaur and he was so fat. Like, he had Ethereal Blade, he had Dagon. Heart, Vanguard, and everything you can think of, but he just stands there and he can't, after his initial burst of damage, he just can't do anything else. So.
He killed one and then he'd watched his whole team die while he waited for the E-Blade and Dagon to come back up. Like, oh, well, I don't know what else I can do.
That was basically the story.
It'll be a very, that's like a demoralizing game, not so much for the team morale, but more for the central pick. Like, if anything, that game's going to make Imperial second guess pick Centaur just because it's like he had all the farm in the world, couldn't carry a game.
But it should. I mean, it doesn't... I don't think that Centaur fits in that position anymore purely because... well, he got nerfed. The illusions got nerfed, rather. That was the only gimmicky thing that could make him worth to go for the safe lane farming, and now someone else just should have priority that can fight better.
Yeah, if you want to do a safe lane, you have to have a mid that dishes out more damage. They had a Warlock of all heroes. You need, like, a Shadow Fiend or a Sniper, one of those... DPS type mid heroes, but Centaur is not going to be able to carry the game once he gets past. So, but Gripbreaker, Noia's hero, can only imagine. Don't normally see this in the offlane. Good pairing with a Darkseer, kind of a old school combo nowadays. The Darkseer, Gripbreaker. Secret gets the Witch Doctor wanting to contest this. Cask has just been. Every game I've seen a Witch Doctor just seems to be insane, paralyzing Cask, winning games. Again, two melee heroes running at you. If those two heroes like run it like an ogre or jug through the cask and turn that around very easily, the pick works very well for lane.
Because you're saying safe lane. You're thinking it's not going to be an aggressive tri lane coming out from Team Secret?
I think so. I think that... Who would you match up against Darkseer? There's possible dealers like Batman.
I guess Juggernaut by itself is
Witch
decent.
Doctor Jug is fine. Like, you've got good zoning potential from a Witch Doctor. Jug doesn't mind the Iron Tail harass too much because he's got healing ward, so... Remaining. I think it's very stable lane to just do Witch Doctor Jug, Ogre Roam between the safe lane, the mid lane, helps out where he's needed, and then you just pick up some kind of 4-0 hero for the off lane. I was going to say Axe, save hero for him, but that's being banned, so... He's... Sometimes playing the Tide Hunter, it seems to be a hero that probably really likes to draft these days.
There's the Invoker.
They looked at it and said Invoker is going to be a really good matchup against all these melee heroes. Ursa doesn't feel great with Invoker because of the Cold Snap, the Ice Ball, the Forge Spirit on him as well.
So they know. There's a lot.
It's it's not great. They can always enrage, stop some of the damage coming in, but it's not an Ursa who's playing around a lot of disabled. The Spirit Breaker that blocks them here is down, but there's not the best disables to make the Ursa pick for. There's no Batrider. That's what I'm trying to say, I think.
No. Okay. So Imperial, they need one more hero. Most likely it's going to be their the mid-hero that they put up against the Invoker. Assuming that they want to put the Ursa against the Invoker.
Yeah, they could. Baby Knight's played all kinds of weird heroes, but...
Sniper has, by the way, been banned in all three games, or all two games that Imperial has played so far.
Sniper this game. It's okay. Ogre's going to go bully him is the problem. Spirit Breaker wants to be able to help out the offlane more. I think the Spirit Breaker level 1 doesn't match. Ignite is just a better spell than Charge at level
5 seconds remaining.
Probably not the easiest game to play Sniper, but who knows? Any mid-hero is going to suffer against Ogre pressure.
Team Secrets, turn to pick.
Okay, well, let's see what they're going to go for. We first have Team Secrets pick.
Yeah.
They're lacking the 4th hero. They went for Tidehunter earlier today. That was hype. Would that fit? We've seen a lot of mech timing pushes come out.
Yeah, I like it because it just provides the mech carrier for the team. It's been a team fight. Timbersaw, be greedier often. But the supports themselves, not greedy at all. They're very good at making space in the early game with Ogre and Witch Doctor being a very selfless hero. So I think this pick could definitely work. And it's against one of the melee heroes. Against only the one strength hero, but pretty decent as well.
The Imperial. So, mid. Maybe. Well,
they get a Timber counter.
Baby Knight likes
Baby Knight style.
The Sniper, likes Shadow Fiend. One of those right-click heroes.
He plays the Brood mid. I don't think
he does, actually. Also one of the heroes that got banned against them.
Yeah. it's weird because I say cheesy picks. I feel like so much of his hero pool is unconventional heroes. Silencer is exactly what I've seen him play in the mid lane a bit.
Yeah.
10 seconds remaining.
They're considering, and again, you mentioned the Ursa could go mid. I think that's still a possibility, Shiva. But a standard hero, but just outrageous.
I forgot that OD was still in the pool. But it's an OD against an Invoker. Should be fine. Should be good.
Yep. Works out. All right. You're good at killing forward spirits, and pretty good at dealing with the lane, even with the reduced base damage on the OD. Always is tough to. Again, we'll see the Ogre probably assert his dominance around that area of the map. Overall, I think liking Secret's draft, I don't think they got the offlaner they were necessarily looking for, but the pool was somewhat limited towards the end.
Yeah.
And other than that, I think the draft has worked out.
Okay, well, let's see. Let's remove that before I forget.
Oh, yeah.
Has happened. Seems to be a theme.
Imperial are going to play very. This is a fighting. If they're not getting kills and fighting in the first 15-20 minutes, they're not winning this game. They want to get to that stage where Darkseer is a mech, they put an Iron Shell on Ursa, put an Iron Shell on Spirit Breaker, charge in, blink in with Ursa, and just fight for kills and fight for dominance. They can't play it. You lose a farming game. You don't have heroes that farm all that fast. You don't have heroes that are going to scale to the limit.
Okay, let's do the predictions. First blood, 3-6.
0-3.
0-3.
Fight. Let's go.
Okay. Highest amount of physical damage a hero will do to another one.
One hit.
To another in one hit.
This is jug crit, so it won't be more than 750. Will it reach 501?
If Ursa builds up stacks.
Good, that's a lot of stacks.
750
How much damage
one?
Is, I think. 0-5. I didn't see anyone. But.
Crit.
Crit? With a jug?
I think so.
Okay.
We'll see.
A lot, yeah. 500 or 750 is quite a lot.
Yeah.
Play with highest total magic spear damage by 25.
So okay, done to heroes, so only heroes.
Oh, pure damage counts, by the way. So it could be. If Timbersaw has a good game, it's probably him.
Yeah? Is that Invoker?
Could be Invoker, could be OD, could be any of those three.
Okay.
I don't...
Will there be a tower died before 10 minutes? I don't think so.
Probably not.
Probably not. Okay, let's do it like that. Okay, we are in the game. We have pressed the button for the camera things. And we are seeing Imperial move towards the mid lane. I say that, but there's already one that's already coming from a different angle. We have Ace Ursa, Baby Knight on the OD, Hester Joe Rotman, the Darkseer, Ryze on the Oracle, and then last but not least, it is Noya on the support. Spearbreaker on the side of Secret, Pylite dies. Witch Doctor is there, and he'll be supporting MP's Juggernaut, with mid one playing his signature Invoker, and on the offlane, it will be Forev on his Timbersaw, and we'll see where Poppy will go with his Ogre Magi, but he might be just roaming around a bit, seeing where he fits best. I don't think there should be a first blood before 3 minutes.
I just feel like that. Hopeful, wishful thinking.
Can we still change? We can still change.
Yeah, you can wait for the very last second to decide.
I mean,
oh, they're going bottom. They may have the opportunity.
We'll just do 3 minutes. In the first 3 minutes, we'll see.
I think it either happens at the rune or it's not going to happen.
Okay, well then, it's not going to happen.
They're both going bottom rune though.
Okay, 13 seconds. We'll go for it. We'll go for it. Let's see how this is going to go then. See, Ignite already comes off on the OD. The charge is there. The Kask is bouncing around a bit. Hester Joe's taking a lot of damage there. It's gonna get saved though. I don't think that anybody is actually gonna die. The Sunstrike actually misses. Hester Joe should be able to get out just fine. Has got a salve as well. And in the meantime, on the top lane, Ace is chasing now Forev and is missing him. He doesn't see him. Look at that. It is not there.
Now he's got the creep wave.
And the charge is on.
Should get back to his tower, or is he even going to Timber Chain with the creep wave?
So. He's not even alone. There's also Ryze. Let's see if they can... they can't do it. That's close. Okay, I think that is mostly if you talk a little louder or put your microphone more in front of your mouth.
Yeah, some people say when I'm by my mic.
Yeah, okay, it might cut out sometimes.
Closer.
Yeah, it's just
sure,
hey,
sure.
We missed it.
We got first blood though. Nice.
Yeah, we won the prediction, guys.
It didn't happen at the rune. It happened a little bit after.
It happened a little bit after, but you know, might have missed it. But we're all looking out for your quality, seeing if we can fix the microphone. I think it just cut off sometimes. So just talk a little bit louder. Is all. And otherwise, I'll let OD look at it after. Okay. So. This is a dual mid lane situation, as we got an Ogre and a Spirit Breaker assisting the respectively Invoker and OD.
And if the supports, the Ogre's the scarier one of the cores, the OD's slightly scarier than the Invoker's, so we'll see how much that kind of affects things or comes into play. But what was that?
Yep, that happened. It's a little bit weird
charge.
Going for the charge without a bash anyway. You kind of want a bash.
Yeah. Absolutely. Not that big of a threat until you hit that level 2.
Yeah. Otherwise, it's a bit of a waste regardless. Okay, so Forev should be okay here on this top lane. We'll get a little bit of harassment from Ace, but overall, I think he should be able to get the levels just fine, and he has got the HP regen from the mangoes as well.
That's the important thing, is not dying and getting levels. You need farmers, Timbersaw, but by getting levels, it means you can get involved in fights and kind of come back. We saw like a struggling game from Mind Control and Timbersaw recently, which is what, giving up kills, not getting levels, had to go back to the jungle. You don't want to have to fall into the jungle as a Timbersaw. You're not the best Iron Talon hero, so just making sure you can at least stay in lane and be there, leeching up as much XP as possible.
Yeah, just being there is enough in that case, and it should be okay for the Timbersaw, especially since both of the supports have showed up in the middle lane. Both Ryze and Noya are here. In the meantime, free farm for MP, it feels. Sure, he's up against a Darkseer, and it's not very easy to do that, but and he got first blood. So he's fine in that regard.
Yeah, that makes a big difference for him, killing the Darkseer early on.
And Darkseer is afraid to come back.
Yeah, he's sitting back with Iron Shell. The problem is if you're just throwing an Iron Shell from afar, you're not really getting XP for the wet lane, and you're also not even getting last hits all the time, because Jug, it's very easy to deny against this. I say that as MP misses one,
of course.
You know, it's very easy to deny.
Yeah.
And it's just not really ideal. I mean, Darkseer only has the 6 CS, Juggernaut 14, the 10, 10 denies there against the Darkseer, so that you can already see that. He is prioritizing the denies because of the way the Iron Shell works.
That puppy Ogre with his bloodlusts. That will probably be the only thing you'll see from him this game, guys. Or at least for a long time, he's just going Ignite Bloodlust.
Yep. That's pretty standard Ogre stuff these days.
Cool.
straightforward escape for Fora. We'll see how much longer he can actually stay in this lane. Ursa, good against the Timbersaw, of course, because of the way the Fury Sipes can stack up, and after a certain point, if you get three or four right-clicks on you as Timber, you just can't go to lane because of the kill potential in the lane.
Well, let's see if Imperial can recover a little bit, because so far their laning stage is looking pretty grim. Their mid lane is not doing great, their top lane is, well, it's probably the only one doing slightly okay, but it's still doing worse than its counterpart on the bottom lane for Team Secret.
This is the Ogre effect. Ogre is just... he's really the best mid laner in the game right now, in some weird way, yeah. Because mid lane seems to be won based on support presence, and Ogre is by far, to me, the best support to have lingering around. He can bloodlust your mid, and he can, most importantly, ignite the enemy mid and just trade blows. He doesn't care about being on the enemy high ground, tanking a creep wave to harass because of how high armor he has. So, Ogre is just absolutely the best hero to have as a mid laner on your team.
Yeah, I really like this skill build from Pilot Eye as well, going for the Maledict. It's great against Darkseer because you know he's going to get away from that cask anyway, but being able to do a large amount of damage during the cast that he does get hit in, and that gets, amplified or...
you can combine that with a Sunstrike or something, you're looking good. This Sunstrike could kill the Darkseer. Doesn't look like he's going to shoot it out though.
Well, he's going for, or rather Noya is going for the charge on Pilot Die. Might even be enough for a kill, but in comes MP. He has the spin available as well, and that should be a kill. Surge, Noya. No, he's okay. He's fine. I was never worried.
Evoka has mana. I guess he's busy CSing and not seeing what's happening bottom lane, because both those heroes were in kill range for a Sunstrike. First, the Maledicted hero, and second, the low HP Spirit Breaker. Looks like it's available, but perhaps just didn't get the info he needed. Throw that scan. Where's that scan at? Get that vision.
No worries, it's gonna come. I have faith. Come on, Dendy.
Dendy, this is a Na'Vi alliance. Wrong game, Kiva.
I know, but I'm watching them with a Sunstrike. The Dendy Sunstrike.
Yeah. Well, no Sunstrike attempt, but... yeah, a bit of miscommunication. I mean, that's gonna happen. You're playing with players who speak three different languages here, or more than three different languages. Mid one, not the most comfortable English speaker. Same for the two South Korean players.
Oh, Omni Slash. The charge is on for MP though. Annoya is full back, full on life. Cask does hit, but I don't think it's gonna... it's fine. It's not gonna kill anybody, but it's also just Optimus tracks and make sure that that Juggernaut could get away just fine.
Does put the Omni Slash on cooldown, so this bottom lane gets a lot more manageable for Imperial. They can keep the Darkseer Spirit Breaker down here once they've healed up a bit and continue to contest things, so it does make life that little bit easier. Doug will have to be careful. He's going to be kind of low on HP mana for a bit. And keep an eye on some of these other lanes. Ursa, Ace, how's he doing? Phased, Windlace. Have to see if he goes into the lifesteal or the Blink Dagger. Those are kind of the two main options. How fast you want to get a Blink and how much you want to prioritize being able to take out Roche with the mask.
Well, he's maxing out his Fury Swipes. We've seen a lot of Ursas lately going for max out Urshock as well. Or is that only if you're a mid Ursa?
You can go for it either way. It's a spell that has such a short cooldown that getting a couple points in it is really good. The slow gets increased, the damage gets increased, so... it's kind of your two different ways of playing it, whether you want to go for more in the overcharge versus the shock.
Fair enough. Mid one gets away. Again there, Puppy just standing strong, making sure nobody's gonna pass him, nobody's gonna dive the tower when there's an ogre around. It's too risky. And he sometimes has to go back to base to get his mana back up, but he's always back in time to help out his teammate. Ryze gets Sunstruck as well with the Cold Snap being there. He does get the Cold Snap off, but doesn't matter. Nice kill there for mid one.
Yeah, nicely placed Sunstrike to start off that kill, and suddenly Secret finding themselves up a couple of kills. They're farming across the board. Timbersaw, the one here that's not farming great as far as their cores go, but it's an offlane Timbersaw, and he's got his levels, he's hit level 6 already, and has Arcane Boots, so realistically he's got the items he needs. He hasn't stacked up points in his passive as well. That's the other thing, if you're an offlane Timbersaw and you're only getting levels by massing points in your passive, you're not going to be able to do much damage, but he's got this build where he can actually go for kills because of the Timber Chain.
Yep. And he is, was successfully harassing Ace away there as well.
Yeah, this lane suddenly looking a whole lot better now that he's level 7 and even Puppy showing up at the top lane as well.
Mm-hmm. Puppy roaming around so much is costing him a little bit of levels, but I think that's okay, right? He's level 4 right now. I mean, compare that to the Oracle. Oracle's still level 3 even. Is just fine. Timbersaw also higher in net worth than his counterpart Darkseer.
Very concerning laning stage for the side of Imperial. They're just not getting the impact they'd want from certain heroes. The Spiritbreaker Darkseer haven't really won their lane. They've in fact sort of just lost it down bottom, giving up the kills they did. The OD at mid is struggling to get farm. Invoker's crushing him in CS, yeah, has more than doubled. And then the Ursa hasn't really successfully zoned out the Timbersaw. The pseudo counterpick is not dominating the lane as much as you'd like. So I think across the board, it's a big secret win in this lane.
Well, let's see if Imperial can pull that a little bit straight by getting a kill on the Timbersaw for Rev. Timberchain doesn't hit and they get the kill. Very nicely done. That Timber Chain just a little bit too short to make it to the other side.
Tried to go for the long one, and he had to get far away. He had the level 4, so it was perhaps close, but just a little bit too far away from safety.
Is that enough to, like, for Imperial, how many of those ganks do they need to do to set the record straight?
That gank on itself is not going to change all too much. That's going to be secret making the next move.
Okay.
But with that Fortune's End landing, they will stop the aggression. They realistically need to just, kind of talk about their lineup, and what it's looking to do is looking to fight a lot around the 15-minute mark with the Iron Shell, with the potential Darkseer mech. They don't want to sit back and play a farming game. They're not going to be able to outfarm Secrets, so it can't just be one gank. It's got to be a gank into follow-up gank, into tower, into another fight. They need to play super aggressive Dota. They just need a few small items to do it. Get like a level 6 on your Spirit Breaker, have an urn, Have a 4-star on the OD. Just get these basic, cheap, cost-effective items. Get your level 6 on your supports, and then they're going to take all the fights they can.
Out of all the Darkseers we've seen today, this is probably the most poor one at this stage of the game.
Yeah, absolutely. He's had a pretty miserable time. Normally, if you see Darkseer having a bad lane, he just goes back into the jungle.
Yeah,
but he's
why didn't he do that?
I think it's just a bit stubborn in some ways because of the draft. You see the Spirit Break in your team, and you're thinking, we picked this draft to contest the offlane, so even when you have a bad start, you're thinking, okay, I had a bad start, but let's try and fix this. Let's just keep going back. But realistically, they would have just been better sacking that offlane and just straight up jungling and saying, hey, look, yeah, we wanted to pressure that lane, but it's not working. Let's just maybe leech XP with Breaker, but just straight up jungle the Darkseer.
Well, they went to it eventually, but it will take a while before he has his mechanism ready. Let's put it that way. In the meantime, that bottom lane is free to farm for whoever Team Secret wants to give farm, which at the moment is for Ev. Put in the Juggernaut up top, making Ursa's life more difficult.
What can you do with Juggernaut? He's got Raindrops, Blade Fury, he's got Phase Yasha, so he's very fast and mobile, and that's on a hero you can easily gank. They're going to just move Ace out of that top lane straight into Roshan, something that was actually pinged out, I believe, by the side of Secret.
Was it not? I thought it was maybe the OD. It was either OD or Juggernaut.
Yeah, that's it. It looked yellow to me, but I'm also not good with colors. Didn't do very well in my preschool colors and arts classes, so who knows?
Well, the Sunstrike comes out, and I don't think that, but it does see the Ursa come out, so they know this is going on. I'm not sure if they're going to be on time. They are not going to be on time, and there is now a Timbersaw stuck on the high ground. Will be able to get himself out. In the meantime, mid one might not be so lucky, though, as he is charged, he is dying, and he is dead. Let's put it that way. He died.
Healing a lot in the Astral.
He didn't die.
Yeah, he was. So, the Astral would have killed him if he didn't heal, but all the heals from the Purifying Flames. But that's actually a really bad call. I mean, people look at normally OD Oracle, it's really good. You can spam Purifying Flames over and over again with the aura, but that was a situation where it actually saved the Invoker because he's healing inside the Astral. That's where the nukes stopped coming out. If they actually didn't Astral and just used like a couple more Purifying Flames, they would have got the kill.
And that they Astral also didn't have detection.
Yeah, that too. The Astral worked against them, so that was a unfortunate circumstance for Imperial.
Yeah. The Darkseer died also for that one. The Juggernaut actually got him on top during Roshan attempt. So overall, Imperial, they get the Roshan, they get the Aegis. Not bad.
Not
but they just need to use it.
Yeah, exactly. Getting the Aegis is one thing. It's even with Roshan money, they're still really far behind if you look at the net worth on their cores. The three of the top four are all on that Radiant side and pretty far ahead. If you take into consideration OD and Darkseer and how poor they are, 4,000 gold lead. It's not pretty for Team Imperial with Roshan. So this Aegis has to be turned into good fights, good towers, just good brawling in general. Triple Nautels were from Baby. Now that's definitely signs you're having a bad game, but...
This is a smoke gang, by the way. Pylai die. Forev, they want to try and get Baby Knight. He has not gotten Astral Imprisonment right now. There needs to be some extra backup, though. In the meantime, Invoker does end up going down in the mid lane to the Darkseer and the Spirit Breaker, but the fight is here. They get the OD. Ryze, that Witch Doctor ult to it, is doing a lot of damage to him, and
it's enough to get the kill. Even with an Aegis, he could just be killed twice, so yeah, he scurries himself out of there.
I mean, there's still an Omni Slash available as well.
Wasn't Invoker death? I guess that's some good news.
Yeah.
I'd say, where did he die? I didn't think he was at that place. He was at mid.
Spearbreaker and Darkseer got him.
Okay.
And that was, I think, the first Spearbreaker level 6. Oh, not level 6. Never mind. He's already level 8 now. Surely he got a lot of level skill in that Invoker. Level 11.
Invoker Jug Duo bring me a problem, and they've realized, like, okay, the Jug's online, let's not get Timbersaw online, because you don't want Timbersaw to be playing recovery mode. This is a hero that needs his Bloodstone, his items to be effective, so
yep.
They're giving him the easy farm on the map. They're sending MP to some of the tougher lanes to be farming in, but it hasn't stopped MP from farming. Still top of the net worth, still having a good game, and Imperial have a lot more to answer for if they are to turn this game back in their favor. They are not playing a comeback lineup, they're not playing a farming lineup. They've got to go fight. They also just don't push towers all that well, so they really need to find the kills if they ever want to take objectives.
They want to try to find the kills on this bottom lane. They've rotated all five heroes here. There was a scan just a moment ago from Team Secret, though, and that scan saw people from Imperial next to their tier 1 tower bot lane, so they knew that they were coming this way, and they have backed off. They're basically giving the tower away if they would want to have it. But they would take the other tower on top tier 1 in return, and that is a trade that Imperial doesn't want to take. They want to fight! And it doesn't look like they can, or can they? Ursa actually jumps up on mid 1, has to back off again, does get the Maledict on him as well. In the meantime, Timbersaw actually is in the back of the fight, already kills off the Spearbreaker, will end up dropping to Ace. And Ace still has an Aegis as well.
On Timber. Whoa, he dropped fast.
He dropped very fast.
Between Ursa and Oracle, you're two of perhaps the best burst damage heroes in the game at the 15 minute mark, and they blew him up.
Well, that's a 1-for-1, but a trait that Imperial will take for now. Because, you mean, you're saying that Imperial's a team that needs to fight all the time, so at this point, even trading, is that even enough for them?
It's not really enough for now, but it's still favorable because they're killing a higher priority target in the Timbersaw. They're trading a support for a core. You're also behind, so any kind of 1-for-1 trade, even if they're heroes of equal value, is better for you when you're behind, but considering their lineup is designed to fight and win fights and take kills and win the game by getting kills, it's a worry that they're not getting enough. This is starting to get better though. Again, you've got to just keep going from kill to kill. And I think a big part of doing that is making sure they have the right vision. They had the Observer Ward there to set up that charge, allowing Noia to lead the way, and having this kind of wards up is going to be instrumental for Imperial if they want to keep playing this aggressive Dota.
And they translated it into a tower, of course, as well, which is great.
Yeah.
So Imperial getting a little bit more of a solid footing on this game right here. There are loads of teleports in, actually. They want to fight this Noia. He's going to be able to charge away. The tower is still on their
siege.
They're going
with the cast. Stop the charge.
Stop the siege creep, and we'll get the kill as well. They do lose a tower. It doesn't get the knight, but good kill. But I don't think that Imperial, again, I don't think that they're too sad about that. They got the kill on the Invoker, they got the tower. That's good. On to the next one. They didn't seem to want to focus on the top tier one tower, though. Unfortunately for them.
Yeah, the bottom and mid are the ones that help secure you Roche better, because they're the two towers close to the Roche. That top tier one tower pro, it's just lower value. So, that's a cute little ward.
This is a Juggernaut in the bath.
Yeah, I bet that. I've never seen that ward before.
Oh. What about the cat, you know? Well, that was probably, maybe a Nexon thing. Okay. Baby Knight.
Four star. He has an item.
Full Null Talisman build.
Yeah, tough times. No kill involvement for him, but he's kind of the one trying to use the space from the Ursa Spirit Breaker to just farm away, get some items. But the Force Knife can at least come to some fights now, but he needs to make sure if he is going and taking and getting involved, taking part, he needs to not be dying, because that's going to completely ruin his game and his ability to scale into the late game if he's going down in those fights.
Yeah, let's see. It looks like Team Secret wants to try and make something happen here. Same thing goes for Imperial, though. They're all in that dire jungle. They don't need a smoke to do that, as there's almost no vision on Team Secret. There is actually literally no vision for Team Secret in terms of wards. No wards up. One observer in the hands of Pile I Die. That's all there is. Let's see if Imperial can make a play. It doesn't look like they want to try it just now. There's a lot of people missing from the map, and they are a little bit hesitant to fight into something that they are not entirely sure of who's behind the juggernaut that they saw on the map.
It's always a risk here to go for when you've got all the defensive tools, the Blade Fury, the Manta Style, and here you go Secret. They've smoked up there. Seeing and sensing weakness in Imperial, they want to go fight.
Yep. So yeah, first target. Omni Slash as well. Omni Slash while well charging away.
We'll good choice to use it because you know he's going to charge away, so you can kind of, as you say, follow him while he's charging away. They actually got a Medallion on Ogre. This is not an item you normally see, but it's kind of like a why not get this item. It makes you even tankier. It also allows you to throw it on someone like the Invoker, one of your cores that's being hit by the Ursa. Having a fast Solar Crest against Ursa is amazing.
They get the stun and the cask off beforehand. He's taken so much damage. He does not have an Aegis anymore. He will be able to get a kill on the Timbersaw, though, but
he's
let's see if that falls.
He should have life-filled enough.
Yeah, he did indeed, and he will be okay.
Oh, good turnaround.
Yeah, Witch Doctor was dead as well in that fight. They do lose the Tier 1 tower, but that's okay.
Yeah, it's absolutely okay, considering they got two key kills. They took down the Timbersaw, who loses Bloodstone charges, a newly picked up item for him, and Secret just didn't really have the best follow-up. They fought without the Omni Slash because they used that for the Spirit Breaker.
Yeah.
They're playing without it, and something that Imperial do manage to punish. So, a good time to win a fight. You know that Roche is going to be coming up like sometime in the next 2 to 3, 4 minutes or so. And you can kind of look to just take control of the Radiant Jungle, get some vision and some wards up around that area. And so we'll see what the next moves are going to be. Is everything okay?
Yeah, I think so. I'm not sure what that message meant. I never saw that before.
I bet I've never seen that in my life. Frame thing.
Whoop. Oh, yeah.
Nah, we're fine.
Anyway. There we go. We're good. It happened at this exact same moment as a pause, so it kind of got me worried for some reason. Okay. So, let's take a look at how the game is looking right now, because Secret was ahead for quite a bit in terms of laning stage. They came ahead of the laning stage, but it was Imperial that needed to go for the aggression.
Mm-hmm.
They did, got some kills, and Team Secret kind of fell flat.
Yeah, and I'd say about 13 minutes to 25 minutes is where Imperial are meant to be strongest. So the question is really, have they done enough during this period? They managed to reduce Secret's lead. To me, it's going to come down to the next Roshan. If Imperial can get a kill, secure Roshan, and then play around the Aegis really well, then I think it's safe to say they've done enough and they've got themselves a position to win this game. And even at that point, it doesn't even feel like it's a dominant position. It's just a position where they maybe have a slight advantage, because right now it still feels like they're slightly playing from behind.
Yeah.
Just because Secret's Draft is more of a late game lineup. They've got Jug, they've got three cores, Timber, Jug, Invoker. Heroes that don't really shine yet. Invoker, him especially, takes a lot of items to be a big scary threat. So Imperial, next Aegis and next 5 minutes is really the big important stage in my mind.
I know what went wrong. We lost all in-game audio. And the stream did as well.
Oh. Sorry, stream.
Sorry,
RIP32 audio. We can maybe fix it after this game, I guess.
Yeah. If they can, yeah, and they can still hear us, so we're good.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what happened there.
God. Peculiar. Oh, Noya. This is a tricky combination to find who you're going to go for. You're going to go... he's going to get backup. He's going to get actually a lot of backup.
He's telling his team, like, I see them. They want to kill the Jug first, but they've got to respect the casket.
Yeah. Well, the Jug is already dead with Witch Doctor just put on the sidelines for a bit. And Pilot Eye will... Yeah. Quickly follow suit.
Yep.
Very sad.
Yeah. It didn't feel as brutal without the Ursa swiping sounds, you know? But like a... much more mild and calm death.
Yeah. Okay, I have a new job. You make the sound.
You're the play-by-play caster.
Oh, shit.
Your play-by-play is now just making the
yeah.
What's the TP sound? Can you do a TP sound?
No. Close enough, though. It's a very annoying sound. I mean, that's close enough.
What's Surge sound like? Soaring sound. Soaring's got a good sound to it.
Yeah, but good luck trying to copy that.
Yeah, exactly. Good luck trying to make digital sounds. We need slacks for that. He could do it. Why is he left us?
We really do need slacks for that. Is he awake yet? I don't think so. He said he would be waking up at 5 p.m. So.
Okay. Well, when Slack wakes up, we'll bring him in. In replace of having Dota 2 sounds, you're gonna have slacks.
That will be amazing. Can't wait for that. I can try to see if I can fix it. Perfect.
Okay.
No, this is where it should be.
So
otherwise, Owen will shout
out. Focus right, probably.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what happened. Or the software.
Probably the software. We'll find out what happens, guys.
They're casting Na'Vi Alliance, you know, they got places to be, El Clasico's to cast. All that action happening over on the other BTS stream.
Yeah. Oh yeah, they actually heard Toby shouting in the background.
That was him trying to do the Dota 2 sound.
Oh, he would actually be really good at that, I think.
Yeah, probably. I could see that. Versus is really farm. Normally here that doesn't keep up in terms of net worth. But because of the kills, taking Roshan, there we go. So he got the second Aegis without a fight. He's ready to fight, he's going to hit level 16 soon. Ace is the player that can turn this game in Imperial's favor. If anything, at this point, probably like fairly close in net worth. They've managed to get a few key kills on four heroes, then just need to keep up this fast tempo game.
It's pretty impressive that he hasn't died yet, indeed.
Yeah.
And same thing goes for Puppy, actually. Ogre Magi, just 0-0-4.
Puppy never loses a fight.
I'm just gonna let that one hang for a second.
I deserve that silence.
I'm like, should I respond?
No.
Okay, they jump in, they get the ogre. That's a nice kill. I mean, a caster's curse hasn't died yet. They die right now. Sorry, Puppy.
Oh.
And maybe.
Oh, yay! We're right about something.
Dude!
Wow.
It's everything!
So
oh,
we're discussing downstairs,
everything.
Is there any reward predictions?
Shit.
I don't think you get anything. We looked in the compendium and there's no prediction.
Yeah,
you don't
and
get
I
any
think,
point.
I think you're gonna be right with the crit thing of the Juggernaut. He's not gonna get to that.
Yeah.
He's only had, like, the highest crit so far is, or two, highest damage so far is 2-something.
If the game goes, like, 50-60 minutes and he gets like MKBs and butterflies, then you'll see it, but to get a 500 plus crit, you need a long, long game. Because Jug's crit's not like a PA crit. Doesn't crit for enough.
Yeah.
But.
Maybe Ursa can do the damage in a really long fight. If there's a really tanky person, it's not going to be for F, I think, though. He's actually dying fairly fast in these fights.
Yeah, that Ursa's, with enough fury to swipe, but we'll see. Maybe Ursa gets a DD. Again, DD Jug, there you go, you've got a 500 crit. The DD runes is the other kind of
Let's do it, MP! He gets himself the Diffusal Blade, that's great.
Yep. He's doing pretty well here.
Yeah.
Imperial, though, are the ones who want to keep playing this tempo. If it goes late, though, I mean, you look at Invoker, again, this is where the Ursa's going to kind of struggle to fight into some of these heroes.
Let's see if Imperial can find this fight, because they are looking for it. Like, they really want to fight it. Sorry.
They've got the Aegis. They know that this game is not going to go as well for them the longer it goes. perhaps, I mean, if OD manages to keep on farming, it's really been Baby Knight just in farm as much as possible kind of mode. He doesn't really go to the fights with his team. He's telling his team, I'm only going to go to fights that I know I'm going to get kills and stay alive, but for now, he's slowly climbing his way back up in terms of net worth, and he's going to be the answer to the Invoker in the late game.
I thought they were going to smoke.
On secret?
Yeah.
I mean, they could, but they only want to do it if they know Imperial is split up, because you don't want to team fight so much right now.
No, and they did get the counter ward going as well, so. Yeah. They know that's up, and they know this is up. And there's a charge. Run, puppy! You didn't die for a very long time, and are you gonna die twice? No, sirree, not today. Tornado lifts up two in the air. They will be able to get the counter ward going as an Imperial gets the wards from a secret down. Really nicely done.
Yep. Again, shoot. Imperial not really finding the kills they're hoping for. They are managing to get some good map control, take some towers and objectives, though. So, it's kind of like a consolation prize. Ideally, they want to get some pick off and then get the towers, but the towers at least is something. It just feels like a very slow pace for an Ursa draft with an Aegis. Normally you see Ursa with an Aegis and it's like bang, 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 fight, diving towers, getting kills, and then as an afterthought you take a tower. It feels like Secret is doing a really good job avoiding them and keeping away from any kind of engagement.
Yeah. But well, so far so good. Mid one is starting to look pretty stacked as well, actually. His highest net worth on the map now.
Invoker things, I guess. You farm so fast, yeah. Alacrity, Fort Spirits, Midas.
So the question just I have regarding Invoker, or rather the struggle that I have with Invoker, is that sure, you can have loads of net worth, you can be on top of the net worth chart, but transferring that amount of net worth into actual impact in a team fight seems difficult.
Against non-BKBs, pretty good, but it's good that Ursa and OD don't have BKBs yet, because you want to have a long duration BKB in the late game.
Yeah.
So if your BKB gets down to 5 seconds, that's when Invoker starts doing really well, becomes a strong hero again. So we'll see them probably pick up BKBs as like a late game I pick up. Ursa may not need to because of the Ag Scepter, so maybe not even a consideration for him. But for now, still just playing that kind of farming mode. Imperial get the Lincolns on the OD, so still looking bit by bit better for Baby Knight. To think how badly he got wrecked at the lane stage, he had to buy 3 Null Talismans and just play this very defensive style OD. It's at least a little bit better than it used to be.
Yeah, Imperial is once again in their enemy's jungle, Team Secret. Haven't had that much map control for a little while. They try. They are able to counter ward some of Imperial's wards, but Imperial is still the one that tries to go for the fights more than Team Secret is, so still getting that map control going for them and applying the pressure as well, and maybe are going to get their wish of getting a fight here on this bottom lane. Both Team Secret and Imperial are gathering. Just Invoker's missing. Let's see if Imperial can get that initiation. They really want it. They are gonna jump in. Ace is the first one. Jumps in on the Ogre Magi. But Ace, he is actually he's actually getting controlled loads. Can he actually do something here? He can't find his target. There is a lot of damage going through though, and the Timber Saw is not gonna make it out. Witch Doctor is already dead. But Ursa still gets the kill with the curse. As in, Ursa dies to the curse.
Not ideal outcome for Imperial. I guess they'll get the T2 tower as well, but here comes Secret looking to fight back.
Yeah, there's the Juggernaut instantly. Oh, he gets put on the right as he goes for the Omni Slash, I think. Yeah, oh, he didn't use it, never mind. I was confused there for a second. Tornado into Sunstrike. Noya can't charge away this time. Drops down. The rest of Imperial managed to make it back to base.
So overall, pretty good hold from Secret. They do buy back the Witch Doctor there in the end. Pi's net worth really kind of tanks a bit, but he's got the Ghost Scepter, which is at least something against the Ursa. He's not going to be able to easily deal with that. He doesn't really want to fill one of his limited item slots with a Diffusal Blade at this point. Perhaps just going to hope for the Stuns of Spirit Breaker or the Fortune's End of an Oracle to help him out, purge it off.
Yeah.
And the longer this game keeps on going, the better it is for Secret. So again, it just doesn't really feel like enough for Imperial in that kind of a fight. I like the idea to go for the Shadow Blade just because It allows you to kind of play that scouting type role as an Ursa to set up the kills and then use the blink a bit later when you need to jump to someone. But Secret were ready for it. They had the sentry ward on the ground. They saw him come in. They got him with the Maledict. They did enough damage that it just wasn't really the ideal outcome for Imperial in that fight.
He was still doing quite a bit of damage during that time, though. I mean, you're right, he got tornadoed up in the air and stuff, but overall...
Yeah, the Oracle always helps guarantee it. You pop the False Promise on him, and even if he's going to die, at least he deals damage before he goes down. So, see what he goes for, I guess, his next item. I feel like he needs something, give a bit of survivability, be it the Accept or the BKB.
Yeah. Well, Imperial, they're still looking for those fights, I guess, or at least still sticking together and wanting to go for things again. Ace on the front lines looking for a target. Maybe Pyladai is going to be the one this time, but again, Team Secret is just very conservative with their positioning. They're very careful. The moment they don't know what's going on, it's not great.
Yeah, and I think they want to play the long game too, just because they feel very confident about how their lineup works and functions in the late game with a high level, high farmed Invoker. Invoker just gets better. It's one of the few heroes that actually gets stronger, like, with levels past level 16. Most heroes just getting some stats, like, become slightly better carriers, but Invoker, his spells and his options just actually become that much more powerful later on in the game.
Yeah, just fighting their time, rather. Fuels, that's the Darkseer right there, and comes to stun as well, inside the Chakram. Do they have the damage to take him down? I think they do. There is another Yules, because why not, to set up for that Sunstrike.
Style points.
Yep, very nicely done, and clean kill overall, and that is Team Secret taking a kill without getting a trade for it. Yep. And I think that's one of the first one that Imperial loses without getting anything in return.
Yeah, they've kind of had a good kind of run here, but it's really taking them a lot of time and effort. The low kill score is very much a sign that the game's going well for Secret overall.
Yeah.
I think Imperial, if they looked at this draft and said what are kind of their markers for a good game at 30 minutes, they'd be saying, oh, we want like a kill a minute, or at least close to a kill a minute. They would be taking Roshan and using that to play very aggressive, and they just haven't found that aggressive tempo that they've needed to take it to Secret. And this time it's going to be Aegis and Cheese in the hands of Secret. Imperial, without a Darkseid, just unable to contest this.
Yeah. They knew what was going on too. They scanned it, and they just weren't fast enough.
Right.
That being said, Team Secret does take the Roshan very fast at this point.
Absolutely.
273.
Yeah, that's good. I think it actually will require a 6-slotted Jug or a DD rune to beat 500. Wait, no, you predicted over 500 actually. Oh,
yeah.
So we need the DD rune.
We need the DD rune. My bad.
It could happen, don't worry.
You should have gone with your prediction. No, you know, also, they have like three options. Why would they put the other... Like, the other two options are never going to happen.
It's more... I think they have a default set of options, so if there's like a PA in the game, you don't. They don't change the options based on the heroes in the game.
Fair enough, I guess.
Like,
some
if
heroes
a PA,
have better chances than others.
I guess PA is really the only one. Sven, I guess, with Daedalus, can always do like one cake for it.
By the way, guys, we are aware that there is no in-game sounds, and we'll try to get it fixed before the next game. Sorry for the inconvenience. Okay. Team Secret, I would say, are ahead, right?
Yeah, strategically ahead. Gold-wise, XP-wise, not really. It's relevant, of course.
So what's their plan?
Sit back, I guess.
Really?
There's so little like Imperial could do to win this. It's kind of an odd thing to say. Like, they don't have to do anything. The pressure is on Imperial to make the plays happen, but with that said, Secret just got themselves Aegis and Cheese, so if there's a time to go, it's trying to make a aggressive maneuver using these items. The Invoker is getting very powerful and scary. Level 17, not quite at that full potential yet, but Jug going for a BKB, so maybe an item they potentially wait for here, but for Secret, they don't even have to get a lane of racks with this Aegis. This is just... like chill time for them. If they really want, they can use this Aegis and Cheese just to keep farming and maintain this level of late game progression, because the progression for Imperial just is not matching them right now. Not even in terms, like, again, the graph showed a very even game, but it's more the way the heroes are matching up. Spirit Breaker, we saw this last game with the VP actually. They had a really good start and Spirit Breaker just dropped off so fast. Ursa, similar story where he's just not going to dish out as much damage later on. The good news is, again, that he can still go for the BKB in the late game, which means 10-second BKB versus Invoker.
Oh, finally, Dying Puppy gonna be the target. Puppy getting charged, but he's already behind the Teardrop Tower. Mid one gets himself out. They get him though with the Nether Strike and a Vacuum Wall there as well. Mid one had the cheese. He'll be okay. Can't say the same for Puppy though. He's dead. Pilot Eye charged by Ace. Yeah, there's. Oh, no, there's no way he's gonna live. Forev tried to come in to save him, but I think that's gonna be his death as well. I think this is a fight that Imperial is gonna be very happy with. As long as they don't get caught out. That's one. Oh. That's gonna be two, most likely.
I don't see him escaping post-Astral.
Nope, I don't think so either. And Ace is still there. Uh-oh. And he gets Cold Snap. And the Vacuum actually helps out getting MP closer to that Ursa. They're turning this around. MP blinked forward, wants to go for Hesse Joe. Hesse Joe is trying to teleport out, but he won't be able to. There's Yule Scepters, plenty on this team. Four dead. It started so well. It started so well for Imperial. But then there's a buyback from the Ogre.
Yeah,
and then everything turns around.
They use so much on that initial engagement where they don't kill the Invoker because of the cheese. I'm sure they'd probably taken note, like, okay, he doesn't have the Aegis. Aegis is elsewhere. It's on the jug. If we can kill and burst down the Invoker, we can win the fight. And they found the Invoker, but they just didn't quite have the chain stun to prevent him from getting the cheese off because they started with the charge of the nether strike onto the Invoker. So
yep.
They'd used the majority of their stuns and... as a result, Imperial get put on the back foot. They've got no Ursa buyback. Darkseer can, but it may just be a lane of racks. I don't think fighting without the Ursa is going to be a possibility.
Yeah, I think that's why the Darkseer is not buying back. It's like, why bother and try not to die, because this would be a very bad time to die for you as well, baby knight. I love that MP actually went for the Darkseer, knowing that the Ursa would already die by his teammates. That was just good awareness right there, so very well done. And Team Secret will take the melee Rex and back off. And they win a fight, they get Rex. Imperial win a fight, and they take too big of a hit themselves to make anything happen afterwards.
Yeah. And, I mean, for Imperial, again, we talked about what does Secret do. They've got Aegis and Keys. They just sat back and wait for Imperial to come to them. I mean, there's so much pressure on Imperial to make the moves because of the nature of their draft. It's not going well into the late game. And just it's a draft that wants to be aggressive and be the playmakers, but... we saw there, Secret just have the answers now. They've got the levels, they've got the farm they need, they've reached this point where they can take these fights. And when they ran outside their base, even if, let's say, Invoker does die, he could have potentially just bought back and won the fight very easily for Secret. So I think Secret were in a comfortable position there, regardless of the Invoker living or not with that D's, just because of the fact they have a buyback or two. Worst case scenario, Invoker dies, he has to buy back, you get a kill or two. Maybe you don't even get those kills, but you're never going to lose a rack there if you're Secret. You're always in a very safe, secure position.
Yeah, and their high ground defense is indeed also very, very decent with the heroes they have compared to Imperial. They have iron shells. It's not too bad. Again, Imperial again on the side of the Radiant team. Team Secret again and defensive position.
Yep.
Just waiting for Imperial to make their move once more. Just come to me, my babies. Yep.
By the way, for those of you on Twitch, you can watch on... I believe they're showing this game on the other channel,
BTSQ,
now.
So
you can watch
own...
with Dota 2 audio there, because they're using Dota TV.
That is Beyond the Summit 2.
So you can get your audio.
Get your audio. If you really want it. Baby Knight.
Interesting build. The Lincoln Octarine, very defensive in nature. I mean, the Lincolns is the Octarine. Like, I don't even know what to say about this item. I'm not an OD player. I don't know... what this item, I'm kind of theorycraft a bit about it, but it just doesn't seem like an item you'd normally see on an OD. I just get some question marks in my head about what he's doing, what he's thinking, but he obviously has something in mind with the pickup.
Yep, must have. Letting all the damage be done by the Ursa and just backing up the Ursa when needed with the big ult.
It's a very short cooldown on the Astral Imprisonment with it, so you can always kind of have that available for the defensive save. Combine that with the Oracle, you've got a lot of defensive tools. And then the lifesteal is kind of so. It's pretty good when you drop your ultimate if you're doing a lot of damage with it. Suddenly you're really hammering home some good damage output.
Yeah, I think they want to try and make it go. There's a lot of teleports coming. Ace already here. Oh, Abyssal Blade as well. This is a nice kill for Imperial.
Wow. Well played by Ace to find the back end.
We got it.
508.
508.
Yep. Barely ticks over with the Fury Swipe. Shiver,
you
were on point with these predictions.
Well, now the only thing is, they can't do that when they have a double damage rune.
Yeah, you can't surpass 750.
Yeah,
I should be safe. There's only so, the thing is with Fury Swipes, there's only so many hit points that Hera has, so once you get up to like a 500 Fury Swipe, you've hit them so many times that they've got to be about to die. Like, I don't see being that likely to get more than that on a Fury Swipe.
True.
But with the Enrage, you never know. Enrage buffing up that damage output always influence that.
Yeah, okay, so Doom Secret lost Invoker, but that's fine. He has buyback as well if needed, which is not needed. That
it's a good pickoff, but it doesn't change the state of the game that much. But for Imperial, it's like, let's just get as many items as possible and hope for the best in the late game. That's kind of the plan right now. It's still a winnable game for them. You keep up on farm, even if you have a weaker late game lineup, as long as you keep up on farm, you put yourself in a position where you can win the late game, because late game just comes down to decision making more so than your lineup strength, because of how volatile late game is with buybacks, and when you have all these heroes that are six slotted, one mistake suddenly means Arax is gone. And again, we're seeing Secret make these mistakes, and people find pickoff after pickoff, they're tearing them apart. This is Secret giving Imperial little openings into this game.
It's a slight sign of impatience, I guess, since it's, you know, we've seen Team Secret basically sitting inside their base for the past, 20 minutes or so? Waiting for Imperial to make the moves, which they do.
Even when they had the Aegis, they got Aegis and Cheese, and they were still kind of sitting back, not doing all too much as far as aggressive play goes. So, it's looking like a kind of flat and uninspired Team Secret. I think, again, it goes back to the fact they probably look at their draft and say, oh yeah, we're fine, we've got this good late game draft.
Yeah.
How are they going to beat an Invoker late game is probably what they're thinking in their heads. Like, Invoker is really good against this draft in general, but I quickly change. I mean, Ursa can look, just be bursting him down, can pick up a BKB still, and they've shown an ability to pick off mid one, so positioning is going to be key. In these next few fights, and Imperial, they're good to go. They smoke up again. They don't seem to hesitate much with these. I think you smoke both.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like using a smoke.
Oh, Radiant use scan same time
that
though.
Too. Yeah. They'll scatter that immediately, but they're on the other side of the map, so they should be able to finish this one off.
Yeah,
I don't like. The smoke's just such a precious resource in the late game. Using a smoke for Roche just seems wasteful, but not the end of the world. They still get Aegis and Cheese. I just wish they didn't use smoke for. They could have just walked in and taken.
They're okay with taking this fight. They're going in. Baby Knight, already Lincoln's popped. BKB on for MP, has got the Omni Slash, goes for Ryze, gets the kill on the Oracle already. Now Juggernaut, oh, Abyssal has to try to get himself out of there. In the meantime, in the backhand of the fight, Perev is trying to hold back the Spearbreaker. He's already dead, actually. MP spinning away. Now Ace getting kited. Cool Snap is there. Thinking about turning around, but it's Cold Snap is doing some work. Nice cheese. Now MP has to back off again, and it is Ace just here that is trying to stay alive. Now the rest of the team comes in with the Darkseer, Vacuum there. Baby Knight already used his Sanity's Eclipse. It is Hester Joe that will end up dropping there in second, third rather. MP still drops. Took a long time for them to take him down though. Mid one, fuels is up, the OD. The pilot.
Oh, clicked it.
Oh,
and double tap.
Bye.
But Ace fights.
He actually episode as well.
Just like no shenanigans.
But that was a 3-for-3, and I have to say,
it was very sloppy fight.
Yeah, from both sides.
Oh yeah, absolutely. A lot of kind of misspells and unsurety about whether to go in and what fights they wanted to take.
Yeah.
Ursa kind of got caught out alone, and Secret did a really good job finding the supports very early on, but then they didn't have a good way to deal with OD as well as Ursa, because they basically just come out on top of that fight purely because of Aegis and Cheese. The OD would have died if he didn't have Aegis. The only reason he doesn't die is because Secret decided not to use spells.
Yeah.
He jumped into three or four heroes, and Secret could have blown up the Aegis, but they're like, wait a second, this is a bad idea. Let's save our spells for Ursa, who then got the Cheese off and managed to survive himself. So, not the ideal fight for either team, but some split push play coming in up top.
Yeah, for Rev. Having a little bit of trouble there, but he wants to go for Noya. He misses the Timber Chain though, and False Promise is also there, so Perev decides that he wants to just get out. In the meantime, the Range Strikes will still drop. Creep's doing the job there. And I think Noya will be okay. Yeah. Another Linear, like the full Linear Rex down though, and that's actually a pretty decent thing for Team Secret. They can just continue split pushing with mid 1.
And that seems like, that's where I look at these heroes and drafts and just like, ah, it feels like Secret should win this game. Not convincingly, like, I feel like it could take a while and it may be a slow win, but it's going to take a lot of pickoffs and a lot of great plays for Imperial to win this game. Like, if for Imperial to win this game, they've got to play amazing Dota. For Secret to win this game, they just have to play fairly decent. Play safe, standard, secure Dota.
Well, that was an Aegis. In the meantime, Omni Slash as well. Oh, on the curse as well on both. They see both. Ursa will drop here too. There's no way he's going to make it out of that one with the curse
up. But yeah, he's gone.
He's very gone. And of course, OD's back alive because he had an Aegis, but wow.
I tell it out of there, and I imagine the Secret will look to force buybacks or force another fight. They are in suddenly a very decisive position, having won that fight as convincingly as they did. A great Omni Slash, the cast between two with a two-man Maledict destroying Imperial.
That shouldn't have been a fight, though. Imperial was not... Like, basically, OD was on their attack, probably shouted something like, oh, help me, team. And then all the team comes in one by one, and then the positioning is not right, and then obviously OD is back alive because he has an Aegis, but then the rest of his team dead.
Yeah, it looked like he thought he had a pickoff on the OD, so he went aggressive, like chasing after them, like, hey team, come help me out, I found a kill, I've got an Aegis, let's play. And the game plan from the start was, let's chase, let's go for kills, let's fight. So OD's probably just like finally on board, like he's finally got an Aegis, he's probably thinking like, finally, like, yeah, I can do this, let's go fight. But his team didn't really have the best follow-up or backup to it. The Ursa really couldn't do a whole lot in that fight because of the way he got chained in that task and got caught by a Maledict. Again, he feels like he needs that defensive item. Can't just play around going pure damage output at this point anymore.
But they only get a tower. Yeah, it could have been worse.
Definitely could have been worse. Ursa buyback, I guess. Yeah. So that's something that Imperial... prevent them from being aggressive, and also mean if they get picked up again, it is actually DD.
Well, speaking of the devil, pick up again, you say? Well, nice vacuum wall still there. Maybe that's enough to chase Secret out of this one. MP already spins himself out. The Witch Doctor dropped. Oracle has a bit of a problem there with the Timber Saw, but I don't think that that matters that much if they get the Timber Saw kill as well. And it looks like Secret is the one on the back foot. Secret is the one that... Oh, there's still an Omni Slash available as well.
Versus low, he doesn't want to fight.
Oh, they get the Dark Seed. That's a dieback for him.
The Ace is still nearby. He's invis. He's chasing, looking for a fight.
The mid one is still in this as well. Nice EMP. Heals himself up in the air. And Forev is back in this as well. Ace still gets a kill on the Invoker, but Invoker is back. He's teleporting back into the lane. And he wants to fight this Ace. He has his Blink up full in a second. He uses Abyssal Blade, Juggernaut. Cold Snap's there. They don't have the vision. There's a gem on the ground. Please, someone.
Did they see him?
Yeah, they see him again now, I think.
No, they're guessing.
Pick up the gem, guys. It's right there.
No one had item slots where he had to drop his boots to travel to pick it up because they didn't have room. He was actually just blind guessing with that Tornado Sunstrike it looked like. And slightly off. That was so close to a kill on Ace.
I was gonna say, because the Tornado and the Ice Ball looked like they were aimed.
It really did. I mean, these players have a sixth sense for, like, knowing enemy movements. That's why they're 8k, 9k MMR pros, and we're just sitting at home like, oh yeah, he can see him, right? No, he blindly guessed that.
But that fight, there was a buyback from the Invoker, there was a buyback for the Timber Saw. Is that worth it for Team Secret? Because they didn't get anything off the back of it other than... They didn't even get the Ursa. They can't even push high ground.
In the end, it's not worth it. At the time, you're thinking, let's do this because if you kill the Ursa, you can win the game.
Because
you know he's got no buyback. You also know you can then kill the Ursa, push mid, and force the OD to buyback, and then OD's fighting without the Ursa alive. So it's... At the time, it feels like a good plan because you know Ursa doesn't have the best ability to fight after that initial outburst, but... The late game Silver Edge, the invis, just proven to be a bit too much. There was like one Radiant Center in the neighborhood that gave kind of some hints as to where he was, but it was just too far to the north. Once he got below it, it was out of range, and at that point they were just guessing where to throw spells.
Yeah, and even that almost got him, but unfortunately, mid one, not able to do it. The Sunstrike, could have been it. Could have been a moment of glory. Well, they'll try again though. I mean, they still... You feel like they should be more careful now that the Timber Saw and the Invoker bought back, because now it goes both ways. If they lose a fight, then Imperial can get very far ahead because there would be no buybacks on Team Secret.
Absolutely. Secret have a better job, a lot easier job at pushing out these lanes. So between their three calls, all three of them can push lanes pretty well. Which means even, like, normally in Voka, if he's getting picked off, he's getting picked off very deep in a lane because he's split-pushing aggressively. Well, that's a big drop in the net worth lead.
Yeah, but at the same time, 4k in 51 minutes is not that much.
Yeah, it's more the fact that it's gone 6k back Imperial's way after that those buybacks, but look what Imperial got. So Ace did go, he went for the Ags. I talked about the Ags or the BKB. It was going to be one of those two. He needed something defensive, and Ags allows you to activate it during a stun, and also just has a shorter cooldown so you can use it more often. And you can see how long he's staying alive in these fights, and these fights are dragging out, so having the Ags means he might get multiple enrages off in a given team fight.
Both going for Team Secret. They draw on the minimap. Want to go for Baby Knight.
That's
the Baby Knight
play.
Has a cavalry back.
He's got buyback too, so it's not like a game-winning pick or anything like that. But not to say killing an OD always good, but make sure you don't get caught on the retreat with an OD buyback.
There we go. Lincoln's already broken. Rev jumping in next, but there's already an Abyssal lit up on the Juggernaut from the Ursa. Vacuum into Wall coming out as well. Oh, the Witch Doctor ultimate combination with the Deafening Blast and a Meteor. Ursa not able to do anything. This Cold Snap is wrecking him. Thank you, Oracle, saving Ace for the moment as Ryze himself has to be careful. So far as Juggernaut and Spearbreaker that have died in this fight.
Heal up Ace. I'm surprised he healed himself there. Ace was actually quite low after the False Promise.
Yeah, and they find themselves the Darkseer. The Sunstrike doesn't hit, but it doesn't matter. They get the kill regardless. That's 2-for-1. Not a very favorable trade, but...
It's like an evenish trade, I guess. You're killing a carry for an offlaner and a support. I mean, it's not too game-changing of a pick.
At the same time, you're not going to be able... If you're Imperial, you're not going to be able to force out a buyback.
Yep.
And you're not gonna do any make any pressure happen on any of the lanes.
They need to find those big, like, Invoker type pickoffs at this stage if they want to be able to make something happen.
Well, maybe they can find Baby Knight, but not
today.
Need
to Hex Baby Knight. I think if they have a Hex, it gets a lot easier for them. And he's got a lot of items, some unconventional ones with the Octarine Four in the mix.
Oh, let's see.
But, I mean, that fight for Imperial came down to, like, they threw everything on the jug, making sure they killed him before Omnislash could come out, and then they just didn't have anything left for the Timbersaw and the Invoker, and the Witch Doctor, his Death Ward, doing a good amount of damage as well. So.
So who's ahead? Because it's still so
it's
even.
It's still very, again, it's not, like, about gold or experience. It's still just slightly secret favored just because of the hero composition, but it's late game Dota, you know, when... A death from Invoker could just be Secret of Lost the Game.
Oh.
That's a Witch Doctor without buyback. And now
nice
fighting actually gets... You have to deal with Kask. Kask has been winning fights.
Yeah, no Kask right now. Apparently Spiritbreaker's having a little bit of an issue there too. Again with the Timbersaw and the Chakram. So it's a 4-for-3 right now as that is actually Oracle already dead.
Ace is in the
fight. Oh my god. MP. Is just wrecking everybody right now. He's just chasing down everybody. He's just one by one. Now it's Ace's turn, and Ace is just getting kited. He's not able to do anything whatsoever. And the last one alive, it is Baby Knight. He's trying to go for mid one, but now realizes that he is the last one alive. Tries to blink himself away and teleport out. Can he do it? Yes, he can. But he's by himself.
Really? Yeah, that's tough news. Ursa does have buyback again.
Yeah, so does Darkseer.
And Darkseer, yeah. So they bought enough time before they decide to fight that buyback came back up. I don't think they use it just to contest Roshan. I think that's just something you accept. It's going to be in the hands of Secret. Secret themselves, their buyback's about to come back up on the Invoker and the Timbersaw, so both teams will be having multiple lives, Aegis's cheese coming into play as well. See where those go, as it looks like item was dropped by the jug to pick up the Aegis.
Gems dropped everywhere. How many gems are there? Three? Two?
Couple of those, I think both teams had one, and then there was some drop, so. So he drops two, and then he's picking up the deep, okay. You need to make sure you have a gem. You're versing. Okay, he's ferrying all the items out of the pit.
Sorry, I'm slightly preoccupied with looking at what Poppy is gathering.
He is a human curious. Okay, let's say, I'm glad he's carrying a gem, because if he opted for, like, a greedier item, like a. I guess the cheese or something over it, I would be disappointed because you need a gem against the Earth.
Yeah.
If you let him just run around fights and survive because of the Silver Edge, that's game losing.
Oh, Pilot Eye is the one with cheese at the moment. Oh, Ursa is jumping in right onto Pilot Eye. He might need that cheese sooner than he was thinking. Cold snap. He needs the BKB or something. He's just not getting it. Now he's getting bashed as well. He can't do anything. He's getting stunned up. In comes the charge, buying some time. But again, stunned. Ace cannot get off a single hit. In the meantime, though, it is OD that is making stuff happen. Yeah, he's already got the Ogre, already got the Timber Saw. Now Cheers turns on to MP. His BKB is about to run out, though. He has to be careful because this OD is hitting quite hard. Nice charge. Noya Cask bouncing through again, helping out a lot. And the Omni Slash finally there.
Oh, but he banished. He saved the Spirit Breaker.
Yep.
And broke the Aegis. This is not going well for Secret.
Not going well at all. They have only two people left alive, and one of them is the Juggernaut that just respawned from having the Aegis mid one. BKBs gets himself in, Viz gets himself out, and MP. Not sure if he can be so.
I think he's just dead.
He's dead.
Yep.
He is very dead.
No escape for him. The Invoker has lots of escape tools, but if they can push out these lanes, it is problematic. They end up losing the Ranger X at some point at top. Doesn't really matter too much. They're already down the melee. They've lost their tier 3 towers, but they win a big team fight on their side of the map. And
hello.
That's what Invokers do. You TP back, you scramble to defend your lanes, and someone caught alone. Invokers like that.
Hey, that's a stray. I'll take that one home.
Yeah, level 25 Invoker with Ag. You know that guy's gonna get stuff done.
Yeah, showing why it's also one of his signature heroes.
He needs to be careful. He could get solo killed as well if he's not careful.
Okay, well. All the tier 3 towers are down. One tier 4 tower is left standing.
Oh, mid one. He doesn't see the dark. He ran to the left. He had the lane ward, so he's going to go searching now, perhaps. Hex is going to be the next item for Darkseer, so wanting to have that extra bit of lockdown and disable.
Well, Imperial, unfortunately, even though they had a massive fight going their way, they can't take anything off the back of it.
It's really been like
can't
a story this game. Yeah, they kill a key hero or two, and then they like, oh, we can't really push. Can't really do much. But right now, it's still anyone's game. It's still like that slight secret advantage just because of the late game Invoker factor. But I think if you see that last fight, it's very obvious now that Ursa needs a BKB. That's got to be his last item slot. Replace the Vlads, get a BKB. Because even with the short cooldown on the Enrage and being able to Enrage off disables, you can save the Cold Snap and then Cold Snap him after Enrages. Yeah, he takes no damage, but he also deals no damage during Enrage. So as long as you prevent Ursa from killing you, eventually the Enrage will wear off and then you can kill him. So I think BKB is just a necessity for Ursa at this point in the game.
Well, we got a set of ice.
For Doctor, yeah. Yep. That's helpful. Again, it's all about being able to kill the Invoker. They need to find some way to break the Lincolns and then Hex him and bring him down as fast as possible.
The save on
Secret side is not great. They don't have an Astral or a False Promise. It's Imperial who have all the save.
They find the Timber Saw for Rev. Gets forced off to safety. Yules himself up. Should be okay for the moment. The BKBs are on Hester Joe in the meantime as well. MP, he's targeting Hester Joe. This Darkseer is going to be very sad with this newly found size of ice. If he's just going to drop dead, his False Promise might just be as false as advertised. MP. Not gonna Omni Slash anymore, gets Astral as well. It is Forever that is chasing down Ryze, and I don't think there's gonna be anything to do with that one.
Somehow Darkseer survived.
He did survive.
Giving him that extra bit of heal. He may have used it during the False Promise. Even if he doesn't, you get the bonus HP regen when you're below a certain threshold of HP. So
which
he was healing enough. And saved his life. But OD now gonna have to buy back, it looks like. Timbersaw, he bought back, I'm guessing. He's somehow respawned very fast, so his buyback was used, but this is the big fight now.
Yeah, he did
looking for jog.
Nice tornado, mid one, has to reposition himself to get those spells off. Nice stun off, again, this OD is not even going to be able to get his BKB off. He might need to put his BKB on right now. Oh my god, can he use his BKB?
To blink out, I think, just after the Astral.
Yeah, he does,
he'll save
blink
it for
out.
A subsequent fight, but they've lost Ursa without a buyback.
They lost Ursa, no buyback, and that is going to be two lanes of Rax.
They fought so well, they fought so hard, but
GG.
It's one of those things where it felt like for a long time, like, oh yeah, surely Secret's going to win this game. Like, you've got this late game Invoker. Ursa's not going to scale at the late game. Imperial's draft isn't good in general in the late game. They shouldn't be able to win this game late. But they kept showing signs that they could find kills. They looked really promising with the Ursa finding pick-up.